Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's weekly worship services, as always for broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following sermon titled, With Whispers and Shouts, was recorded on the first Sunday of Advent, November 27, 2016, at our 9 o'clock service, and was delivered by Pastor Edgar Schambach. The Gospel reading was from Matthew, chapter 24, verses 36 through 44. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com.
Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 24th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said these words to his disciples. But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, one will be taken, one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken, one will be left. Keep awake, therefore. You do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake, and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Welcome to a new church year. As the Advent wreath reminds us, we are now in the opening of a church year, the first of the four Sundays of Advent. I find Advent to be a very fascinating season. It's so unlike some of the other customary seasons of the year, like Lent with the journey to the cross, or the Easter celebration, or Pentecost. Advent, it's this very unusual mix of experiences. They're the big celebrations and all the flurry of activity, the decorations and excitement, and then there's also the quiet. It's like a deep current underneath all of that big stuff, a deep current. We hear it in Scripture. We hear it in the prayers and some of the songs of the season. And we experience that also in some of the quiet moments we might open ourselves to as we begin this journey to Christmas. There are the shouts of the season. There are the quiet whispers. It could come like a hallelujah chorus. It could be like the choir anthem, to listen. Just that invitation to listen in a deeper way. We experience God. We hear God speak to us with shouts. And we hear God and experience God in quiet whispers. My sense is that God kind of tilts more to the whispers than he does the shouts. My sense is that God has wired his default position when communing with us, when speaking to us, is the whisper, not the shout. And that's just the opposite of us when it comes to God. I think we're wired. Our preference is, God, we like the shouts. We like it when we hear you loud and clear. We want things more precise and laid out for us. If we ask a question, we want you to answer it with no ambiguity. Be clear, direct with us, God. The walk of faith is good. But we like to know a little bit about the steps. We want it mapped out more for us. That's how we're wired. But God is wired more for the whispers. Not that God doesn't speak to us in shouts. Now recall the story of Moses and God on Mount Sinai and the giving of the Ten Commandments. That's one loud shouting story. I'm not going to hear a whisper in that story. Moses goes up the mountain, as you recall. People of Israel down below, kind of at a distance because of all the pyrotechnics that are happening there on top of Mount Sinai. And God and Moses, they're in conversation, and there's thunder and lightning and wind and fire and the earth shaking beneath his feet. Seems like it should be like that if you're on a mountain with God. And then out of the cloud, when it's all said and done, God gives stone tablets with carved Ten Commandments to Moses. Clear as day. No ambiguity about it. It's all spelled out loud and clear. Sometimes God speaks in a shout. But if you stay with that mountain and step forward into the scriptures, to the book of 1 Kings, many generations later, another great leader, his name is Elijah. Elijah and Moses, two of the great giants of scripture. Elijah, the one the prophet John the Baptist is patterned after. And Elijah, we find him at a point in his ministry just devastated. His soul is filled with despair. He thinks he's failed God, failed the people. He has failed as a prophet. So down on himself. Despairs of life itself. God, take my life. I'm done. I'm useless. And in that despair, God sees him and reaches out to him with an angel, a ministering angel. And the angel ministers to the prophet. And the angel encourages Elijah, Elijah, take a journey to that holy mountain of God. Remember how God spoke to Moses on top of that mountain. Go and be with God. So Elijah takes a 40-day journey to the holy mountain, goes to the summit, and just like in olden days with Moses, there's fire, there's smoke, there's wind and tempest. The earth shakes beneath his feet. But no God. No shout from God. A lot of noise, but no God. And the story continues. Elijah, after all the pyrotechnics are done, he steps out into the stillness. And he listens. He listens from a place deep within his soul. And he begins to hear a whisper of God. Now, the English translators are puzzled about how best to put this into English, the picture language of the Hebrew. And some of the translators say Elijah heard a still, small voice. Other translators said he heard the sound of sheer silence, kind of a paradox. But he was in tune to a whisper of God deep in his soul. And that whisper was powerful, even though it was a whisper. It banished the despair, gave him peace, gave him strength and resolve to return and complete the mission God had given him to do. God speaks with a shout from his holy mountain. He speaks with a whisper, too. Shouts and whispers. God, I think, prefers whispers when speaking to us more than shouts. And I wonder why that is. God, why do you prefer the way of whispers? Why not stick with the shouts? Well, my sense is, and it's strictly my sense of it, my sense God likes the whispers. Well, I'll explain it this way. When I was a youngster in confirmation class, like many of you, we had those catechisms. And I learned Martin Luther's six parts of the catechisms. That's just about 10 or 20 pages in the book we had. The rest of the book was what a teacher had written for us to learn, trying to explain God to us in clear, uncertain, you know, very certain terms. There were all these questions. It went on for like 100 pages. I think there were 350 questions and answers with all these proof texts. And they were spelling it out in black and white, clear as can be for us kids, what we should know about God and His ways in our life. And it was done, I would say, in a loud, shouting kind of way. There wasn't any whisper. And all of those questions and answer. And it kind of talked about God in this way. It said, these are the traits of God. God is omnipotent. That means almighty. That's a loud shout, isn't it? And God is righteous. And God is holy. And God is this. And God is that. You know, those were loud shouts, just very defined traits, defining, describing God to us kids. And missing from that list were all the other ways that we experience and know God, especially as children. You know, kids, they find God in a butterfly, right? They find God in all kinds of surprising ways. But defined were all those loud shouts and then no whispers of how God might speak to us with mystery and wonder. And the quiet nudges of God, and a presence of God deep within the soul, and how God likes to surprise us. And we wonder and we scratch our head, was that you, God, or was that just a coincidence? None of that was in the list. I think we like God clearly defined. Notice I'm like putting him in a box. Now I know God. And God's saying, oh, no. You're missing a big part of it. You're missing all the whispers that I give to you in your life. And so we open ourselves to whispers. We can't contain God in our mind or our soul. He's bigger than that, more mysterious than that, always surprising us. Sometimes we think he's gone from the picture, and then we discover, no, he was always there, but in a quiet, mysterious way. I remember another conversation God had with Moses. That's the burning bush. Remember that famous story? And Moses is in the Sinai wilderness. He has fled from Egypt because he killed an Egyptian officer there who was beating one of the Hebrew slaves. And Moses fled for his life, and there minding sheep, his own business, something he caught in the corner of his eye, and he turned, and it was this shrub, scrawny old shrub, but it was ablaze with the glory of God, and it caught him at the corner of his eye. It's kind of like the way God does it sometimes, not right in your face. And Moses turned and drew near and realized he was on holy ground. God said, take off your sandals. And they had this conversation, a very mysterious kind of conversation there before a burning bush. And Moses realizes he's being called to go back to Egypt to liberate the Hebrew slaves. But he wants something very specific from God. He says, I'll go, but I need a name. I can't go and stand before Pharaoh and say, I had a conversation with a burning bush. That isn't going to work for me. I need something concrete, something well-defined. I need your name. And I could just see God smiling at that, saying, you want to contain me and put me in your box to carry with you. I'll tell you what, I'll give you a name. Tell Pharaoh, I am sent you. Yeah, that's the name I'll give you. I am who I am. What an ambiguous kind of name. But that's the name God gave Moses. We like God to be more defined to our expectations. God continues to speak to us with a whisper. We ponder it and experience it more deeply in our souls and come to know it more fully. John the Baptist, he will be before us in the next couple of weeks of Advent. I think John the Baptist was someone who liked to see God in clear and precise terms. He was a shouting kind of guy. And he expected God to be that same way. And so he will come, as we'll hear next week, repent. The kingdom of God is at hand. That's a loud shout there in the wilderness. And he will say, the Messiah is coming and he's got his winnowing fork in his hand, and he's dividing wheat from chaff, and the chaff are going into the fire, and the wheat into the barn. And a little, that fire and brimstone preaching, that loud shouting kind of preaching. And that's the kind of God he was ready for. And then one day, as he's baptizing those poor sinners who came out to him, he looks up and he sees Jesus. Jesus from that podunk town of Nazareth, standing with all those poor sinners in the water to be baptized. And John says, this can't be. There's something wrong with this picture. That's not the Messiah I thought would come, standing with us in the water. I should be baptized by you, not me baptizing you. And it all turned upside down. God came to him in a very surprising, mysterious way. We'll hear on the third week in Advent how John the Baptist is in prison. King Herod put him in prison, later would take his life. There in prison, John ponders the meaning of it all, and he sends messengers to Jesus that ask, you know, I need to know, are you the one? You're so different. You're so different from what I was expecting, what I was preaching. Are you the one? Jesus just smiles and tells the messengers, go back and tell them what you see. The blind see, the lame walk, the poor have the good news preached to them. The world's being turned upside down. God speaks to us with whispers. Reminded of one of the famous pictures from the Middle Ages, one of those great religious paintings. And we see John the Baptist, and he's kneeling. He's looking this way, and he's very devoted in prayer, and he's kneeling. And you know he's just praying for the coming of the Messiah. He doesn't see what's right behind him. And right behind him is this little lamb. It's kind of like coming up. Can't you see it? Can't you see it? Remember, John will later say, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, who overwhelms us with such love there from the cross. God speaks to us, I think, more often than not through whispers. One final story, Mary, the mother of our Lord. You remember the story of the Annunciation, we call it. We give it this big name. She's a teenage girl doing whatever a teenage girl might be doing at the time of the day that God paid a visit. And God sent the archangel Gabriel to announce to her that she would be the mother of the Son of God. Now that's a big shouting kind of story. I mean, when the archangel is standing before you with news like that. But then what happened? Because the archangel Gabriel said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you will conceive a son in your womb. And there was then, at some point, this stirring in her womb. God, is that you? Is that the promise? A stirring in her womb, a whisper of God. And she carried that whisper in her womb the 9 months. And she gave birth to her firstborn in a stable. It's a beautiful story. And Mary, when it's all said and done, Luke describes her, she just pondered all of this deep in her soul, pondering that whisper of God. And that whisper was such a whisper, it took her all the way to the cross where she stood at the cross and did the impossible, giving up her own son too, as Savior of the world. As far as I know, Gabriel never visited again. She had one shout experience, Gabriel. From then on, it was this whisper of God, this journey of faith. As we enter into the Advent season, there are going to be a lot of shouts that you can tune into. We'll do some of those shouts here in church even. But I ask that you tune your souls to listen carefully, listen closely to the whispers of God. It is His preferred way of speaking to us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us at St. Paul's Lutheran Church. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.